for 15 years all around the world. And crucially, when writing this book, of course, part of this is based on Gideon's own personal knowledge of some of these strong men and leaders. So it's very interesting to get that sense, of course, and to learn more about that. So what we're going to do, we will be spending the first sort of 10 minutes. Gideon's going to give us an exposition, overview of his work. Then I'm going to ask him a few questions. Then we're going to open up for you to ask some questions, whether you are here in the room or at home. You can, of course, ask. And if you're writing from outside, though, please put it in to the Q&A bit, and I will try and pick up from there and ask questions.
A brief idea of what the book is about. And I suppose I can do it by kind of asking the classic questions, when, what, and why. Before I actually define strongman rule, let me just give you an idea of the kinds of people I'm talking about and why I think it's a really distinguishing feature of modern international politics and something that's really risen up over the last 20 years. I guess the archetype for the kind of ruler I'm talking about, a ruler who very much makes governance about him and his own personal strength, and the people I'm talking about are all men in this case, was Vladimir Putin, who comes to power, symbolically enough, in 31st of December 1999, if you ever wanted a marker of the sort of dawn of a new era. And at the time, this is the heyday of the sort of Fukuyama end of history period, when it appears that liberal democracy is sweeping all before it. And the West's initial reaction to Putin is to see him as a kind of harbinger of that. And Putin plays along, actually. He says, you know, his goal is to cement Russia's modernization, democratization. When Clinton first meets him, Clinton says, this is the guy who is going to, you know, push Russia along the road to Western-style democracy. And we kind of ignore the contrary indicators for quite a while, perhaps because we don't want to see them. And also we're so certain in our own ideological kind of framework that this is the only way that a country is going to succeed in the modern world, that we think, you know, these kind of rough edges, whatever's happening in Chechnya, et cetera. Well, we know the general direction Russia's going. And indeed then Putin, even when he begins to throw his weight around and to actually start saying explicitly, actually, this isn't the direction I'm going and I don't like Western liberalism, perhaps in most notably in a speech in Munich in 2007, the Munich Security Conference, and then by his actions in the invasion of Georgia in 2008, the West's reaction then is to say, well, this guy, okay, he's not turning out to be a Democrat or a liberal, but he's an anomaly. Merkel says he's a 19th century figure in the 21st century. He's you know, and she kind of has a point in the sense that he is going back to wars of aggression that were common then. But this idea that he was an anomaly, I think, actually it becomes clear that rather than that, he was a forerunner of a whole different style of leadership, illiberal, personalized, authoritarian, anti-democratic. And a bunch of other leaders begin to emerge. The second in my book is Erdogan, who comes in 2003. And similarly, follows actually a similar trajectory, both in the international reaction to him and in what he does domestically. Internationally, he is initially hailed as this guy who's going to democratize Turkey, modernize Turkey. Sounds a bit familiar, but it becomes clear, as with Putin, that in fact he is not a liberal by any stretch of the imagination, that he is also prepared to centralize power around himself, to take on the independent institutions of the country, start bringing them to heel, create a personality cult like Putin. And indeed, like Putin, he abolishes term limits on the presidency to allow himself to rule long into the future. The next one, who I think is probably globally the most significant because of the sheer power of China, is Xi Jinping, who comes in 2012. Now, obviously, China had never been a democracy or even had really pretensions to be a democracy, but there were, and there probably still are in the shadows, Chinese liberals who were hoping to move the country towards at least a system in which the Communist Party did not rule everything, where you had independent courts, and maybe one day towards a multi-party democracy. And indeed, again, in this familiar pattern, she is greeted as a reformer by a lot in the West when he comes in. I remember visiting in 2013 in Beijing with a bunch of kind of Western ex-leaders, all of whom sort of were saying, well, you know, this is the guy who's going to push things along. And in fact, he does the opposite. He moves in what is now should be a familiar pattern towards a personality cult. He incorporates Xi Jinping thought into the Chinese constitution of the Chinese Communist Party. He abolishes term limits so that he can rule for life. And that is maybe rubber stamped this November at the next party congress. Moving swiftly onwards, you have Narendra Modi in India. Again, very different system, but it's part of the thesis of the book, and maybe we've been exploring the Q&A, that this is a tendency that actually weirdly spans established democracies and established autocracies, but they're all in different ways, or the ones I discussed, moving towards this more personalized form of governance. Modi, similarly, moves India, who hadn't really had this kind of leader, really since independence, towards something closer to a personality cult. Just to give you a couple of examples, if you get you vaccinated in India now, the vaccination certificate has Modi's face on it. You know, this is a personal gift from him. The largest sports stadium in the country is the Narendra Modi Stadium, which is, you know, not something you really normally do with somebody who's still prime minister. Modi in 2014, then of course the biggest shock to the system is Trump, who comes in 2016, who introduces some of these stylistic quirks into the world's greatest democracy. He, after all, says in his speech to the Republican convention, I alone can fix it. And I think that's a very classic strongman statement. The system doesn't matter, the party doesn't matter, it's me that matters. Look to me. Indeed, if you read the memoirs of people like John Bolton or Fiona Hill who work with him, they're quite interesting on the rapport that Trump feels with people like Xi, people like Putin, people like Erdogan. Bolton says he had a funny feeling watching Trump interact with Erdogan, and in a sense he was envious of him, but that he wanted to be like him. And that there's a bit where Erdogan complains about some case that is embarrassing, a Turkish bank in New York, and Trump says, oh, I can fix that. And of course he can't, actually, in America. It's like you have independent courts, but he wants to be that kind of leader. Trump is obviously the most significant in some ways because of the cultural and political power of the United States. Running swiftly through, you have Bolsonaro in Latin America and AMLO, so that by 2018, you have the two biggest countries in Latin America, both with strongman style leaders. I write about Abiy Ahmed in the book as well. I think, of course, strongman leaders not alien to Africa by any means. They've had far too many of them. But he's an interesting figure because of the significance of Ethiopia, second largest country, and also because, again, you get this pattern of the West getting it wrong. They give the guy a Nobel Peace Prize because we so want to believe that he is a peacemaker, etc. And then, in fact, he launches a war in Tigray, which is now having really pretty dreadful consequences. So that's the pattern. And these are all, if you like, connected anecdotes. But if you look at the numbers overall, people like Freedom House are talking about a long democratic recession, erosion in global liberty every year since about 2004. And I think it's closely connected to this strongman phenomenon. Why is it happening? That is a big kind of unanswerable question. I would love to say there's a single reason and this is it and this is what we should do to fix it. I think there's a bunch of connected reasons and they vary slightly country by country. There is an economic element to it. I mean, clearly the groups that are attracted to Trump in the United States, to Le Pen in France, to Salvini perhaps in Italy and so on, tend to be the ones that are doing badly economically, that have suffered from this widening inequality in the West, and who are susceptible to the, what I call the nostalgic nationalism of these leaders. In different ways, they're all saying things were better in the past. Trump says, make America great again. Xi talks about the great rejuvenation of the Chinese people. Modi is also somebody who's harking back to past glories. And in the West, that takes an economic form. I think in the East, in Asia, it tends to be more looking back to an era when the West wasn't dominant, when their country had the respect that they felt it deserved, or it was, whether it was the Ottoman Empire or the great periods of Chinese imperialism. But they are all nostalgic nationalists. And so there's an economic element, there's a kind of geopolitical element to it. There's also, I think, a cultural element to it. They tend all to be cultural conservatives, unhappy with feminism, perhaps all gay rights. And so I don't think it's a coincidence that they're male leaders. You know, Putin poses bare-chested with a gun. You can't get much more kind of classically macho than that. And finally, I think social media, in a way that we have yet to fully pin down, plays an important role in this. I can't believe it's entirely coincidental that this surge in strongman leadership happens around the same period time that social media is taking off. I think these are leaders who thrive on simplified messages and on direct communication with their followers. I will leave it there because I think I've done my allotted 10 minutes, but we can perhaps pick up on some of those things in the Q&A.
Well, we certainly can. Sam, there's someone saying that there's a problem with the volume. Can you just, is there a way of increasing that? Okay, just a reminder though, you can put questions in, please do, into the Q&A chat. We'll answer those. Also, we will put a link, if it hasn't already gone in, to Gideon's book. If you want to, of course, learn more about the thesis in detail, you will find it in the book, which we purchase in all fine online and physical establishments, and even maybe on social media in that way. Right, so much to talk about. Interesting, you picked some interesting characters in there. I'm going to start with the amusing one, though. What's Boris doing in there?
Interesting question. And I obviously debated, should I put him in? Shouldn't I? In some ways, he's a weak leader. You know, you can see he's tottering around. I did it partly because when I started writing the book, was just, or thinking about writing the book, was 2017, 2018. And although I think people in Britain would be quite resistant to the idea, certainly Tories would be, it was very interesting that traveling the world, that people linked Trump and Brexit very much as twin phenomenon. They saw that they were linked in the time, basically. I mean, Brexit vote happens in June and Trump gets elected in November. Trump is actually in Britain when it's elected, and his instant reaction is to say, we're going to have the same thing in the United States in a few months' time. The constituency of voters are very similar. They're non-urban, tend to be, as Trump says, the less educated. He famously says, we love the poorly educated. And they, I think, are part of a reaction against globalized liberalism, if you like, the liberal international order. Now, that is not how Boris Johnson sees it. I mean, he regards, you know, Brexit as a sort of liberal act. But I talked about these international conversations, which made me think, yeah, there is something there. I remember being in Moscow. Sadly, I can't go anymore. I was just banned by the Russians 2 weeks ago. But I was talking to this guy
very late in the day, Gideon.
Yeah, well, I think there's a, yeah. I mean, I've these lists are slightly bizarre, but anyway, I'm on it. I was talking to Fyodor Lukyanov, who is kind of runs the Valdai Forum, which Putin uses to kind of interact with foreigners.
Yes, yes.
And Lukyanov said to me, he's a very personable guy, albeit perhaps faintly sinister, said to me, have you seen Boris Johnson says that Brexit is a huge sort of boon for the liberal cause internationally? And then he literally sort of burst out laughing and laughed uncontrollably for a minute because the thoughts seemed so intrinsically absurd to him. And I thought, oh, great. You know, this is obviously, if you're sitting in Moscow and you're backing Putin, Brexit's great, you know, that because it's cracking this Western unity, essentially, and the rules-based order, etc. So I thought for that, those reasons, it was part of this global trend, even if obviously every country has its specificities. And I also think that at times Johnson did flirt with the strongman style, particularly when Brexit was in trouble, when he resigned from the May government. He actually gives an interview to LBC where he says, you know, if Brexit doesn't happen, people will conclude there is a deep state of people who frustrate democracy and that who really run Britain. And that's classic Trumpian language. And then of course the prorogation of parliament, the sacking of 26 MPs, it's this sort of saying, you know, we need to get Brexit done, and whatever that we're not necessarily going to respect institutional constraints or even the law. Now, I think the reason why he doesn't totally fit the pattern is that if he had indeed been Donald Trump, when the Supreme Court overruled him, he would have continued the fight. He would have said this is illegitimate, the judges are biased, whatever. He's enough of an institutionalist not to do that. So, you know, he's kind of on the cusp, but I thought it would be a bit odd, certainly for an international audience, if sitting in Britain, I kind of ignored what was happening here.
So you felt, you know, in a way, I'm gonna put it in for that purpose.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, since the book's come out, we've had the Ukraine war, which on the one hand is a complete vindication of what you've said. On the other hand, it does throw up some interesting, you know, kind of points. Obviously, Boris has fallen very much not on the strongman side in this kind of conflict. We're seeing, obviously, though, other of the strongmen standing together on this. And you make point about the connectivity here. I think the interesting bit, Modi's support, for example, for Russia or failure to condemn is interesting in this. Of course, you have the Xi connection, Orban, this sort of relationship. So how has Ukraine, if you like, both reinforced the thesis, but also changed the thesis?
Well, it's made me think, actually, I thought that maybe had I been writing it post-Ukraine, I should have been a little bit more explicit about the connection between strongman politics and ultimately the recourse to violence. You know, quite a lot of what I wrote about was attacks on the law, personality cults. But actually, in fact, if you look back at Putinism, war is there from the beginning. Chechnya, Georgia, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that these are, you know, one of the great dangers of what he's done is that it kind of re-legitimizes the idea of using war to remake international borders. Annexation is back, you know, and we saw that with Crimea in 2014. And I remember writing a column saying, you know, annexation is a very dangerous idea and it's coming back. Obviously, the danger is that China takes this as a cue for Taiwan. Modi, actually, you know, whether or not it was a legitimate use of force, I'll leave for others to judge. But one of the things that I think helped him win re-election in 2019, I think it was that when there was a terror attack on Indians, he responded by bombing Pakistan, which was something that previous governments had not done because of the fear of Pakistani nuclear weapons. And that was a classic strongman thing. I'm prepared to do it. So I worry that sort of the connection between strongman politics and military force, Abiy Ahmed, obviously I mentioned as another, is there. The attitude of the strongmen, I think the Indians would say that on Putin, they are just following sort of realpolitik, geopolitical logic that this isn't their fight. They're going to buy cheap Russian oil if they want to, et cetera, et cetera. There may be an element of sympathy for Putin the man as well. I don't know. But Erdogan's attitude is a bit equivocal. Again, I think it's more to do with realpolitik, that Turkey needs to keep some kind of connection with Russia. It's playing both sides, essentially.
Yes.
But there's no doubt that there's often a rapport between these leaders that, you know, Erdogan and Putin's relationship deserves a book in itself. It's a very bizarre relationship. You know, at times the Turks have shot down Russian planes, they've clashed with Russian troops in Syria, and nonetheless, you know, Erdogan will then go to St. Petersburg and make up. It's said that one of the reasons that he gets on well with Putin is that when the attempted coup was taking place in Turkey in 2016 and the West was a bit silent, Putin was on the phone very quickly offering support to Erdogan. That's the kind of strongman to strongman connection. And I think that the relationship between Putin and Xi is also very interesting. You know, some Chinese, I think, although it's very hard to criticize Xi at the moment in China, feel that Xi was too accommodating to Putin when, you know, we've all got February the 24th fixed in our mind as the date, obviously, of the invasion. But earlier that month, I think it was the 4th, there's this joint Chinese-Russian statement. And Putin and Xi sign up to it. And it's really, it's not just a sort of international cooperation thing. This is a sort of joint ideological assault on the West, if you read that statement. It's a very long, angry diatribe against the West. And I think some Chinese friends and indeed Russian friends have said to me that there's a kind of bond there in the sense that Xi actually admires what Putin has done in Russia. If you look at what he does when he comes in, one of the first things he says is the collapse of the Soviet Union was a disaster. he agrees with Putin on that. We need to study it. We need to study it so that it never happens in China. The party loses power in the way it lost power in Russia. And so I think he admires Putin as somebody who's, in a sense, trying to recreate the Soviet era. And Alexander Gabuev, who's a leading Russia-China watcher, refers to Putin and Xi as the Tsar and the Emperor, in the sense that Xi is returning to a kind of imperial model in China, and Putin is returning a kind of Tsarist model in Russia. And they see something in each other, and that's why they get on with each other.
Yes, that's very interesting. And as I said, the war has sort of highlighted some of these trends as well and thrown them up. One thing I thought which was interesting is that, like I said, mostly things have indicated this. The one area where you rightly, of course, pre the war pointed out, I'm really worried about this, is, of course, the decline of international cooperation, the decline, if you like, of international institutions. Has what's happened in, say, the West and parts of the other global community since you restored your faith a little bit, that actually there is still life in the liberal international order?
Hope so. We'll see. It's early days, isn't it?
It is early days.
That, it's one of the things I'd be delighted to be proved wrong about. I think that obviously the common threat, and I think it's one of the things that Putin miscalculated, that he thought he'd win very easily and that he'd present the West with a fait accompli before we could get our act together. And that anyway, the West was kind of falling apart, see Afghanistan, et cetera, et cetera. And then I think he was shocked by the speed with which not just NATO came together, but also the Japanese, South Koreans, Australians, et cetera, joined in the sanctions and indeed were present at this most recent NATO summit. That is significant. And it's possible that the existence of the Russian threat certainly united Europe. We may have a second win for the Western alliance. I really hope so. But I say it's early days because this war could go on for quite a while. We don't know what the impact of an economic crisis in the West fed by the Ukraine war is going to be on Western politics. You know, if we get some of the more pro-Russian voices in Western Europe coming to power, and that may happen, you know, in Italy, say next, people like Salvini, who, you know, at one point posed in a Putin t-shirt in Red Square and in the European Parliament. He's former deputy prime minister of Italy, still leading the Northern League, if he were to come to power, or indeed, you know, Marine Le Pen, very equivocal on Putin. At some point, her party was funded by the Russians, got 90 seats in the most recent legislative elections. And the big one's obviously what happens in the 2024 US presidential election. I think there's a strong chance Trump will win again. I've been trying to figure out what the hell Ron DeSantis thinks about the Ukraine war, and I don't know, and I think that's probably not an accident.
I think he's
being quite quiet about
it. But I want to you just sort of preempt that, because, of course, your epilogue looks at Biden as being, okay, so Biden is in, if you like, you know, he restores, order for a moment, but, you know, there are all sorts of areas where it's looking shaky, good things here, bad things there. We're obviously 6 months or 8 months on from the book. Mm. It's looking worse rather than better, right?
For him, yeah. I mean, I think Biden, in a sense...
But also in the way he's acting...
In the room feel about it. But it seems to me, he stands very much in the Henry Jackson tradition, in that he says, you know, the key dividing line in the world is between democracy and autocracy. And I intend to make that a theme of my presidency. I think he does that partly for domestic reasons. What he's talking about as much is January the 6th and saying what happened there was unacceptable, that American democracy itself is at stake. But I think he also is doing it as a way of trying to create a dividing line with China and Russia. And I think one of the striking things about the US now is about the only thing I can find there's bipartisan agreement on in Washington. It's not Russia, but it is China.
Yes.
And so that Trump himself had this bizarre relationship with Xi, may indeed have envied him in some ways, talked about using China's abolition of term limits as a model for the United States. And Fiona Hill in her book says, you know, he wasn't joking. You know, she having worked alongside him, thought he was floating it as a joke. But on the other hand, Trump's China people like Matt Pottinger were very hard-line. And I gather that, you know, Pottinger and Kirk Campbell get on fine. It's possible that that sort of Henry Jackson type emphasis on democracy will persist. I think it's quite likely, actually. Now, there's a question as to whether, in terms of realpolitik, that makes sense as a dividing line. And also, it once again opens America to the old Cold War charge of hypocrisy, because some of the people you want to shovel into the Democratic camp are not so democratic. I mean, we talked about Modi, and I think he's problematic for the West. I mean, obviously, he's not an autocrat like Xi or even Putin. And India still has elections, and they're free elections, and so on. But some of the things that are happening in the Indian media and judiciary are make one nervous. But he's, for realpolitik reasons, a crucial ally. Erdogan is an even more acute example of this. But we can see with NATO how infuriating he is. I've just written a column about this, and you know, potentially problematic, keeping the Finnish and Swedish applications on hold. But equally, you know, better to have him on our side than the other side, particularly given the importance of the Black Sea and so on. So the trouble with making these democracy autocracy dividing lines, I'm not saying it's wrong to do that, but they're always complicated. And you always find yourself quickly then on the defensive saying, and I, you know, talking to, say, people in Southeast Asia, it was interesting. They were saying to me, a lot of the region were very nervous when Biden did that. They said, oh no, we're going back to this values-driven American foreign policy. They're going to be breathing down our neck. We don't like this, you know. So it's not necessarily helpful in terms of international coalition building, although I think, you know, as a broad theme, it's one I agree with.
Good. Now, I'm going to ask one last couple or two little questions at the end, and then we're going to come over to you in the room, and we're going to start asking questions from the floor. So we'll come there. Last two questions are on probably the chapter which I thought was fascinating, the Soros-Bannon chapter, yeah. Which probably doesn't get picked up in as much as the general thesis, but it's really very interesting. Firstly, it's interesting because you actually issue a fairly full-throated defence of George Soros, which is not very popular these days. I mean, I think, you know, you're right to highlight that, you know, part of the reason strongmen don't like him is because he is funding civil society programs that obviously are against what they're trying to do.
Yeah.
I mean, you might give him a little bit of a pass on his political activism. He's obviously got political views as well, which he's not shy of pushing out. But in general, do you think we need more George Soros's?
Yeah, I think he's a fairly unique figure. And I think that, you know, it is interesting that the first people to have a crack at him are the Russians. They closed down the Open Society Foundation pretty quickly because he's funding things like Memorial and prisoners' rights and so on. Then I think, you know, the Turks, again, you know, Erdogan is obsessed with Soros. And, what you know, I have to say, a close friend of mine just been imprisoned for 18 years in Turkey, who was head of the Open Society Foundation office in...
You mentioned him, yeah.
In Ankara. And I think, you know, that was why, basically. Now, obviously, Soros, I think, becomes a figure for controversy in the United States. Not so much for that, but because he is, as you say, he's got a portfolio of interests. It's not just democracy.
Yes.
He's very full-throated opposition to the Iraq war. And I think that's partly what begins to make him a hate figure for those on the American right. And now, like, you know, voter rights, I don't have a problem with that, but it's very controversial, obviously, in some places where they've found it convenient to accuse him of fixing the ballots, which I think is nonsense. But also, you know, trans rights, he's a supporter of that. He is a big supporter of minority rights causes, some of which not everybody would be up for. But I think overall, you know, he's not a perfect person either. You know, like a lot of rich men, he can be a bit capricious and so on. But I think what he's done and the causes he's supported are liberal causes and the causes of freedom and democracy, etc. And Central European University in Hungary. You know, he
which, of course, Orban was a graduate, right?
I think Orban actually had a sort of scholarship to
Oxford. Right, okay, so that's...
But, you know, then found it convenient to turn on him later. So, and the closure of CEU and the fact that it's forced to move to Vienna tells you something about the direction of Hungary, as does the fact that a few months later they announced opening a large campus with Fudan University, which had just taken out freedom of, literally taken out the commitment to free inquiry from its constitution. So yeah, I think Soros is basically a decent guy and has put a lot of money behind these causes. Bannon I include because in a funny way, he's doing a sort of illiberal Soros. And I, and you know, Bannon sees it, you know, it depends which day you get him on, but at times he would even express admiration for Soros, but Soros and said, you know, I want to do a similar thing, build up an international network, but just on the other side. And indeed, when I met Bannon, he was in Germany, having just been spending time with the AfD, because he was, I think, rather less successfully trying to build up the same kind of intellectual.
Yes, there was at one point, wasn't there? There was a real push for this. And,
absolutely, yeah. He bought this campus in Italy, and so on. So, but I think that the Bannon people run into contradictions very quickly because, you know, Bannon, actually one of the things he shares with Soros is about the only thing, is a preoccupation with Chinese totalitarianism. You know, Bannon is quite close to Alexander Dugin or flirts with Alexander Dugin, who is a sort of crazy Russian nationalist who's very close to the Chinese. So where all that works out, it doesn't, it begins to unravel quite quickly.
Very interesting. Right, I had so much more, but I'm going to open it up. Who would like to ask a question in the room? Anyone? Right, yes, sir.
Yes, hello.
Just give your name, if you wouldn't
Simon
mind.
Simon Anglin, King's College. We talked about Boris. I'll give another example from recent British history. Borderline personality cult rooted in messiah complex. Demonization of political opponents. Reduction of checks and balances disguised as essential reform. Use of military force abroad, some of it of dubious legality. Boris is in there, but Tony Blair isn't. Why is that?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. But I think Blair was probably more... You'd have to run me through that list again.
And obviously chumming with Putin.
Well, was he? You know, but that was a period when everybody was. Because I think that, you know, you've got a Blair falls in power in, what, 2006, isn't it?
Seven.
It's, I think, before it becomes... I think you're right in the sense that we were all too slow to spot what Putin was about. But on that, I would give it, I'd say that everybody was doing it. You know, that so that Obama, who I'm quite kind about in the book, comes to power, the first thing he does is try a reset with Putin in 2008 after the invasion of Georgia. Yeah, I mean... I am more indulgent of Blair. I think in the end, he was an institutionalist. You disagree, I think. I don't think that, and I think he was an internationalist. I mean, I think that was part of the reason he makes the mistake on Iraq, that he thinks that it's all about supporting the liberal international order, that it's a decision that is led by the United States, a destabilized United States post 9/11. And that Blair, for realpolitik reasons, believing that US power is fundamental to the liberal international order, says, okay, we're going to go along with that. And then you get into the interesting stuff about at what point is normal charismatic democratic leadership distinguishable from the personality cult that I write about. I mean, obviously, all politicians, to some extent, have to say, you know, I'm the one, et cetera, et cetera. That's what they do. But I don't think Blair was ever quite in the business of, say, Trumpian. Boris, as I say, was always a borderline figure, but I don't think Blair would ever have attempted to overturn an election or stuff like that. I think in the end, he accepted the rules of the game, which is why he went. You know, and that was an internal party coup. It wasn't even, you know, the electorate, really. He attempted to create a cult of personality, if you like, but within the kind of rules of normal democratic discourse. I thought the one when you were asking that question, I was saying to myself, is he going to say Thatcher or Blair? Because I've also had Thatcher thrown at me and said, you know, she was a strong leader, etc. But I think, again, the difference was that she didn't break the rules. You know, in the end, she went democratically. I think Johnson, as I say, he is a borderline figure. However, he is the only prime minister, I think, who's been convicted of breaking the law and stayed on in office. So I think that puts him a slightly different category.
Right. Thank you. Yes.
Charlotte Whitworth from the Jackson Society. Listening to the categorization now and thinking that lending itself more to leaders that are quite anti their own establishment rather than buffoons With that in mind, are you fearful of a ultimately even grip on our democracy and our Western order, or do you think the pendulum will now swing the other way because we're so shocked by the way?
Well, we'll see. I mean, I think you put your finger on something very important, and I didn't include it in the sort of little brief summary. But you're right; it's populism, you know, and of which anti-elitism is the flip side, is very key to all of these leaders. So they all say one of the reasons you need a strongman leader is that there's a sort of corrupt elite that's grabbed control of the country, and you need somebody like me to cut through that. Give the real people charge, put them back in charge. And that's in a way partly why they then say it's okay to break the law or be anti-institutions, because the law, the institutions have been captured by this corrupt, often globalist elite, because they combine anti-elitism. The elite is often regarded as anti-national because they are globalized, they're connected to the outsiders, rich, metropolitan, blah, blah, blah. And it is pretty common, so that, you know, Erdogan when I was in India, the Modi people would talk about the Lutyens elite, by which they meant the people who lived in the sort of posh Lutyens era buildings in Delhi, and that they were out of touch with the real India, whereas Modi was in touch with the real India. Erdogan, similarly, you know, if you looked at the Gezi Park protests in 2013, which led eventually to all these trials, which has led to people like my mates being put in prison, that was the sort of Istanbul liberal elite who were often the people out on the front lines. And you certainly didn't see people in headscarves at those things who were the archetypal sort of Modi, Erdogan supporters, and similarly Trump, same business. You know, on January the 6th, when he addresses the crowd, he says, "You're the people who built the country, you know, not these terrible elites, etc." But I think that you say, you know, it's possible we'll have a backlash. I mean, I'm a little discouraged by what's happened, America's response to January the 6th. I think there should be more Liz Cheney's. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think Britain's in a slightly different and more hopeful position. I mean, I look at, say, the response of the Republican Party to Trump and the response of the Conservative Party to Johnson, they're very different. You know, that Johnson has lost his grip on the Conservative Party, and I think they will eventually get rid of him. Trump has not really lost his grip on the Republican Party. Now, I'd like to believe that's because the British are marvelous, principled people. I think it may simply be electoral politics, though, that the Tories can see that Johnson's magic has worn off on the voters. And so they're saying, okay, we better get rid of this guy. Whereas I think that a lot of the Republicans who were outraged by January the 6th, and will privately tell you they were outraged by January the 6th, look at their voters and say, "Oh, if I say this, I'm going to lose power." So it may be that our lot would be just as unprincipled if they felt that the British public was still behind Boris.
Right. I'm going to take some questions from the remote. Now, three people. I've got John Pett. I've got, I've got Melissa Kren and also Steve Paby. All are interested in the future prospects of strongmen, in the sense of they don't live forever.
Yeah.
Some, you know, even end up retiring. How do they retire, if they retire at all? And what happens post-retirement to the countries? You know, do they suffer as a result? You know, can you give any historical examples of after a strongman, does a country do better or worse?
Well, I fear, obviously this question of what happens, how do you end the strongman era rule, is incredibly current, because we're all sort of saying, only we could get rid of Putin. You know, will there be a coup against him? Is he looking a bit ill? Might he drop dead? You know, I think the answer is first of all, the huge flaw in strongman rule is one of the big flaws is the lack of a succession mechanism, is that, you know, democracies, for all their flaws, and strongmen are very articulate on the flaws of democracies, quite good at, you know, like talking about that. We at least have a succession mechanism. You can get rid of Boris Johnson or Donald Trump or something. But in their systems, there isn't a succession mechanism, and it becomes indeed harder and harder to get rid of the strongman, precisely because they are rule breakers. They will often have broken the law. They will have sent enemies to prison. They may have stolen money. So it becomes personally hazardous for them to step down, so they can't. And not just for them, it's hazardous for all the people around them. Because they've thrown in their lot with the strongman ruler, and so they may lose all their money or go to prison or whatever. So there's immense nervousness around what happens if this guy goes. And I was really struck the last time I did go to Russia in 2019, that people were already talking very nervously about, you know, what happens when Putin goes. I was saying, it's not till 2024. Why are you worrying about this now? Well, the reason they were worrying about it now was because it was so immensely destabilizing. Everything hung on who the next person would be and what they would do, which in a way it just doesn't in a democratic system. But how do they go? Well, first of all, for that reason, it's not just that they are reluctant to go. There's a whole infrastructure around them that is reluctant to let them go. So I'm afraid they tend often just to die and in office. Okay. You know, Mao died in office, Stalin died in office. And, you know, they become decrepit. And that's also a sign of regime problems, is that nobody can admit that the strongman is actually ill. Or you
Mugabe had been a good example.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Everyone has to, oh, no, it's, yeah, it'll be remarkable. You know, ran 20 miles this morning, very as sharp as he ever was. You know, why? Oh, gaga. But that's the flaw in their system. But it's quite, you know, the numbers who end up like kind of killed, like Ceausescu, or who stepped down voluntarily. I can't think of anybody who stepped down voluntarily, unless it's to give power to their children. Because one way that you solve the succession problem in a strongman system is to turn it essentially into a monarchy and hand over to your kids.
Yes, that certainly solves that sort of particular problem. Right, I've got a couple of questions here from Kevin Sheehan. One, do you think we can look to the populism movement, not quite sure what that is, but the ability of moneyed individuals to change, dictate the media and policy from their interests, has that aided the strongman concept?
I think money and politics are pretty inseparable, and it's inseparable from democratic politics. I mean, obviously, American elections, it's completely out of control. It's so, the amounts of money you need to run for office are so crazy that I think people, democratic politicians, spend far too much on the time on the phone to donors, or far too much time cultivating the likes of the Koch brothers or Elon Musk, who, you know, whoever might be able to fund their campaigns. And that's one of the things that the populists can rightly point to and say, you know, in what sense is this a democracy if they're so focused on the money? Money is important for strongman leaders, but often it's things like, you know, control of the party apparatus or control of the military, classically.
Well, Kevin's second question leads into this. He says, well, are in a sense the weakness of our political parties two things like this? Is that part of the ability of strong men to take power? And he would prefer a more direct sort of form of democracy. However, I'll come back, and of course, historically, plebiscites and such like have been the great tools of strongmen, haven't they?
Absolutely. And I think that, you know, one of the reasons that you can sort of become a strongman on the semi cheap, but no, I think they do need money, but is the way in which social media allows you to collect directly with followers. And I would say point to, well, I think almost all of the leaders I write about in this book are quite adept users of social media, or at least the people around them are. You know, I guess Modi, you know, once you get going, things get easier, because then businesses start to fall in behind you because they need favors, and then money starts flowing in. The BJP was already an established political party and would have had quite a lot of support anyway. But somebody like Duterte, Bolsonaro, I guess they're right-wing figures, so there's always some constituency for that. But what they are particularly good at is using Twitter and Facebook. So that the 2016 presidential election in the Philippines is probably, I think Facebook executives later called it the Philippines patient zero, because it was the first election before even the US presidential election where they saw the use of fake news, I mean real fake news, not the stuff that Trump labels fake news, pumped out as a way of creating alternative narratives, bypassing the traditional media, which does boring things like fact check and say, you know, maybe this isn't true, we're not going to use it. Whereas you can get these very, and I think social media is also very good for highly messages that go viral, the ones that get you in the gut, that are very emotional, very simple, 3-word, 6-word slogans. And if you're good at that and you can weaponize social media, you're onto something. And I think Bolsonaro, again, was a very adept user of Twitter, Facebook, and so on.
So I've got an interesting question about Modi here from Michael Ezra. So he's very interested in India, obviously, given it's, you know, it's a grassroots democracy. It's the world's largest democracy, of course, in this regard. He says, look, he's not so worried about the Putin thing, India's, you know, realpolitik is well known in this regard. But he does, of course, look at, he says, you know, how long will the Hindu majority, he says, tolerate the systematic crushing of political opponents, silencing the voice of the Indian people, criminal oppression of Muslim communities, and high-level corruption? And what's Modi's actual end game point? And was it COVID that in the Indian case really allowed him to expand his power? Was it something happening before?
Look, it's been a while because of COVID since I've been to India, actually. Right. So I'd like to go back and get a sense more of what's going on. I think my sense with India is that it was a relatively gradual process, mm-hmm. that when he came in, you know, the people were prepared to give him the benefit of the doubt. I was, actually. I thought, you know, he was democratically elected. There were real question marks about what had happened in Gujarat during his period, but clearly he was, you know, Congress was a bit exhausted and corrupt itself, et cetera, and so on. But I think that, certainly if I talk to journalistic colleagues in India, they feel the sort of vice being tightened kind of year by year. There wasn't like a moment, but it was more that as the BJP becomes more and more powerful, then they get control over different levers of government. And I think, you know, Orban's another example of that. You do it gradually. You sort of change laws, you appoint people, you get to control institutions. You make it harder and harder to be outside the mainstream. So that, again, you have to tread carefully with India, because in some ways, obviously, you know, you wouldn't mistake it for Beijing if you were in Delhi. People talk, so on. But, you know, a friend of mine, again, who was head of Ashoka University in India, who's a noted liberal, Pratap Bhanu Mehta, eventually lost his job. You know, it was just too difficult for the, I think, you know, then a kind of a murder comes over it and everybody decides to, like, they're just not going to talk about it. But I think basically it became too difficult for the university authorities to have this noted critic of Modi and liberal running it. And that tells you something, obviously, when somebody like that loses a job like that. But COVID is a very interesting thing, actually. I mean, I think that, you know, we perhaps hear, when you had people like David Icke demonstrating Trafalgar Square, you think, well, all these people are talking about how COVID restrictions are going to be a massive restriction on civil liberties. They're kind of nutcases, aren't they? You know, this is a public health emergency. But if you look at China and what's happening there, actually, I'm afraid it may have been given a huge impetus to surveillance authoritarianism. In that suddenly, you know, if you have a government that has no scruples about this, no checks and balances, they can use this stuff to control people's movements and are doing so. So that there was an example, you may have read about it recently, where there was a demonstration in a Chinese city. A lot of people had lost their money in a failing bank. They were all heading into town to protest. And they suddenly found that their phones had gone red, that their COVID apps had been changed, so that they were no longer allowed to leave their houses.
Wow.
That is, you know, and I think that you talk to, you know, when I challenge, say, Americans in the administration about, you know, hang on, is your opposition to China not just basic, classic, great power, we're number one, we're gonna stop you challenging us, you know, is how much ideology, is this really about freedom, and how much is it about just, you know, American chess beating? They're quite interesting about, as one of them put it, China as a forerunner of what they called a sort of terrifying new form of surveillance authoritarianism. Because China, well, we're all finding, you know, the terror that you lose your phone, you know, and then your bank's on it, your health pass is on it, your I don't know, tickets to the cricket on it, everything's on it, you know, and you're in trouble. Even more so in China, but they moved to mobile payments very quickly. So basically, in a system where the government can tell the every company, you share this data with us, they know where you are at any moment. They know what you're buying at any moment. They know what you're, where you're traveling. They know what your travel plans are going to be. And they can compel the companies to hand that information over to you and do. And then suddenly, okay, so you are unpopular with the government. They can freeze your electronic wallet and you pay with that. Suddenly you don't have access to your money.
That's a disaster, yes.
It's absolutely disastrous, particularly the eradication of cash. Now, you know, some Western liberals, people like Ken Rogoff, for example, the Harvard economist, have long argued we should get rid of cash because criminals use it, you know, and it's untraceable. But actually, if you get rid of cash, then really, and everything's electronic and everything's on your phone, then a government like China knows exactly what you're doing all the time. And unfortunately, the Chinese are able to export these instruments of social control. One of the packages they offer to, say, an African leader who may be an authoritarian himself is, well, you know, the West won't give you this stuff, but we can tell you how to follow every discipline in your country.
Yeah, fascinating, isn't it? Yes, so technology could indeed give this a whole new,
right, sir. Yeah,
a new run.
And it's doing so.
Right, we've probably got time for one more question. Anyone in the room who would like to ask? Yes.
Yeah, Pankar, researcher with the Naval Foundation. Sort of interesting listening to this. Mainly, I thought the question you want is Francis Fukuyama's end of history argument. Do you believe it's irreversibly passed somehow? Have we already gone beyond sort of his Hegelian idea of a liberal democracy, where we're going to end up, where the world is going? Do you think now sort of past that? Is that, you know, is that still a goal we can go back to? It seems like a lot of liberal democracies, like flourishing ones like Russia, or even Turkey, they're now reverse course.
Yeah.
So is there a way back?
I hope so. Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, obviously we can't give up, but you know, I suppose maybe the way to say is that the Fukuyama was being slightly ironic when he used the end of history phrase and so on, but maybe if you'd recast it as an aspiration rather than as a description of what was going on, that would be better. I mean, I think that, you know, in intellectual life, a lot of it is down to luck. And I remember I interviewed Fukuyama for a previous book about how the whole thing took off. And he was like a graduate student who'd then done some time at the State Department. And he had written, do we have time? I'm sorry, I've got a minute or so.
I'm just posting the link.
So he was invited to a conference on the decay of democracy at Chicago University. And he said to the conference organizer, actually, you know, I think the opposite's happening. I think democracy is about to really become globally ascendant, because he was a graduate student studying the Soviet Union and he could see what was happening inside Russia. And so he came and gave this talk on a panel a bit like this. There was some magazine editor in the audience of the National Interest. He said, oh, that's really interesting. Why didn't you write this up? So he wrote it up as an article for the National Interest, kind of an obscure magazine, obscure enough that both, I'm sure, Alan and I have written for it. And it comes out in the summer of 1989, just as the Polish roundtable talks are going, and then is on the sort of newsstands when the Berlin Wall falls. And everyone says, my God, there's this thing saying the end of history, and becomes an sort of international intellectual celebrity on the basis of what was a genuine insight. But, you know, that his career was kind of made by that. And I think even he would now say, yeah, obviously he was too hopeful at the time. But I do think these things go cyclically. And I think that, you know, one of the things ideas I float at the end of the book is that you have these 20, 30 year cycles. And maybe that was the beginning, or maybe even the middle of a cycle of upswing in democracy. Because actually, even before the Berlin Wall fell, Latin America had had a wave of democratization in the 1980s. You know, China had obviously never become a democracy, but have begun to liberalize a bit from the late 70s. And then by 2005, 2006, the circle turns. And it may be because ideologies overshoot. You know, everyone gets really overconfident. They write books called things like The End of History, and you maybe try too hard, or you the flaws in your model become evident. You have a financial crisis like the 2008 financial crisis, or you become so messianic about democracy that you invade Iraq and try to make it into a democracy, and it's a sort of disaster. And so everyone says, well, that's obviously a terrible mistake. We need to try something else. And there's something else that a lot of people are trying right now is the strongman model. But maybe Putin's invasion of Ukraine or the sort of complete mess of zero COVID in China will persuade people now that, well, actually, the strongman model we thought was maybe the pretty good, that too has its flaws, and people will begin to become conscious again of the need for checks and balances, for freedom of speech, all those things that strongmen say actually were not necessary. So I suspect that, you know, no system has the perfect answer. I think anybody, you know, who's coming to an Henry Jackson Society event probably has their preference for liberal democracy. But I think it's cyclical, and that hopefully some of the flaws in the strongman model are becoming more evident. And the difficulty is, as we're saying, is that whereas liberal Democrats give power gracefully away because that's part of what we do, the strongmen don't.
A very appropriate way to end it. Thank you, Gideon, for giving us the benefit of your expertise and for your thesis here. Reminder, you can buy the book. Those in the room can buy the book afterwards. And Gideon, I'm sure, will scrawl words of wisdom in the front for you. Those at home, you can, of course, pick it up from the link I've put in there as well. Gideon, thank you. It's a tough subject, of course, but it is very prescient. It's, you know, really on our times. And we can only hope that, as you suggested, it may be an epoch, but we are heading towards the end of this particular epoch, and it will indeed resume along the lines of the more liberal democratic futures that we would all subscribe to here. So thank you very much for joining, and I hope you'll join in. Thank you, Gideon, the usual. Thank you. Right. Feel free to...